Hi, everybody. This is Steve Mitchell. I'm the producer and director of the upcoming documentary True Believers, and here is our second Patreon podcast. Just as a quick reminder, this is something that we're going to be doing for Patreon subscribers, where we're going to keep you updated about what's happening with getting True Believers shot, cut, made, and on the screen for you to enjoy. And one of the other things that I'm going to do for the Patreon audience is I will be sharing anecdotes from my comics career, which, in case you didn't listen to the last podcast, and what the heck, why didn't you? It's a career that spanned, I think, over four decades, which is, as I say it, it's a little hard to believe, but there it is. Now, last time we talked about the first time I went to DC Comics. And today, what we're going to do is I'm going to talk a little bit more in depth about some of the experiences I had when I was at DC Comics. One of the things that was so great for me as a young fan, and I was a huge fan, I don't even know that comics fans were called fans then. We were called losers, dumbbells, idiots. I don't even think the word geek existed. But I was a fan. I read virtually everything. I think I had a newspaper route, which afforded me the money to go spend on comics because I bought almost everything, but I was a Marvel and DC guy. But one of the things I talked about in the last podcast was that DC had a Thursday after lunch tour. That's how they described it. It wasn't how I described it. And the Thursday after lunch tour was oftentimes a gathering of some of the hardcore fans in New York City who wanted to go to the offices and interact with the pros, hopefully, that would be there. So we would go up every week, usually during the summers and during holidays. The rest of the time, of course, we're in school, in the hopes that we would have a close encounter with some of our heroes who wrote or penciled or inked or, in some cases, penciled and inked. And here is a couple of memories I had of some of the guys that I met at the time. I guess I should start with the big guy first, Neil Adams. Neil was working at DC in the production department, utilizing one of their available drawing boards. And it seemed that Neil always liked to go to work somewhere. And this is something that, as the years went by, he wound up having an office at the 909 Third Avenue DC offices, which he shared with the great Murphy Anderson. And then eventually Neil wound up starting his own studio. But Neil always liked the idea of going to work. Again, this was a very professional, greatest generation kind of thing. And Neil, unlike the rest of us, the greatest generation, the true believers, as I call them, the blue jean generation, as I also call them, Neil wore a tie. Now, Neil wore blue jeans and a button-down shirt and a tie. But Neil wore a tie. Very few of us did. Anyway, when I first met Neil, Neil was becoming kind of a superstar in comics. Very quickly, he became the go-to cover artist up there. And he was doing Superboy, lots of Superman, Batman covers. He became very famous, at least in my eyes, because of the Tomahawk covers he did. The Tomahawk covers were some of the best covers he ever did, and they were great illustrations. They were great ideas, but also great illustrations. You should go online and try and find them, because if you're not familiar with them, they're really some of his very best work. But because it's not superheroes, you might not know them. Anyway, when I met Neil, Neil was a very, very young man. I mean, I think some of us tend to forget that Neil did a nationally syndicated newspaper strip called Ben Casey, which was based on the TV series at the time. Now, I barely even remember that. That was before my time. But it was successful, and Neil penciled and inked, you know, six dailies and one Sunday page every week. So if you go online, you might be lucky enough, if you type in Ben Casey, to see some of Neil's newspaper work, which was very accomplished. And the scary thing about Neil was he was very accomplished when most artists are developing their styles. Most artists sort of go through a kind of a trial and error period, and they find their way to what becomes their style. Neil's style was highly developed and remarkable at the time. Now, Neil segued into comics, and he started working at DC. And strangely enough, for a guy who was very realistic and illustrative, Neil started doing Jerry Lewis comics, which he did in a comedic style. But he became the DC house cover artist very, very quickly, and DC was happy to give him space because I think every editor wanted to walk over to him and say, "Hey, Neil, I got this idea for a cover. You want to do it?" And Neil seemed to do all of it. Well, when I met Neil, I don't believe I'd really seen very much of his work. I think he had just started doing Dead Man, which was a very remarkable, very exciting, visually exciting comic, which became the lead feature in Strange Adventures. And because I was a pushy fan, I asked him for a sketch of Dead Man, and he did me a very quick head sketch. Again, very accomplished in no time. And Neil was a hero of mine, and clearly I was getting to also see why he was a hero of mine. He really was a titan, and his ability to draw with a pencil was, and still is, I think, remarkable. And I think he was wary of me and maybe a little bit of the fans. But, you know, when you're an artist, when you work alone, especially if you don't work in an office, most freelancers work at home alone. They don't interact with anybody, maybe their editors. So I think Neil kind of also liked getting some degree of contact with the fans. And if nothing else, it's always nice to get a compliment about your work. So Neil was one of the guys that I met at DC's production department, which, as I said in the previous broadcast, was this windowless and very dark room. Most of the light in the room was coming from lamps on top of drawing tables. It almost felt like an old film noir, private eyes kind of office. You know, it wasn't cheery or upbeat or like, "Hey, we make comics here." It was this interesting environment where you had a lot of solitary creators all working next to one another. I think Murphy Anderson used to come in at that time, again at the 575 Lexington Avenue offices, and plant himself and do work. And then another interesting experience I had is I met a guy named Jack Sparling. Now, Jack Sparling was, if you were a fan of comics at the time, a very familiar face, or at least to your eye, familiar face to your eyeballs. His work was something that was everywhere. Jack Sparling was a guy who worked for Dell. He was a guy who worked for DC. He was a guy who, I believe, also worked for Gold Key eventually. He was very fast. He was one of those guys who was very important to the comic book business because you could call him up and he could turn some work around very quickly. Now, I met Jack as a fanboy at the DC offices, and he was working in the production department, as I said, and he was doing the cover of Strange Adventures number 198. One of the things that was on the cover, and it was very eye-catching to me. I mean, it was all eye-catching. You know, when you're young and you walk, it's like being in a candy store. It's like seeing how candy is made. And we had this character named Immortal Man, who was sort of the de facto star of Strange Adventures at the time, flying over a city, being chased by a couple of flaming apes who were shooting fireballs at him. And they're flying above kind of an area with a lot of oil drums. And I'll read the caption for the cover to you. Is Immortal Man is thinking, "How can I stop these fire apes from hitting those oil tanks without losing my life?" Now, I said hello to Jack. I told him how much I liked it. I was very impressed by how quickly he was inking, considering that my discipline ultimately became as an inker. This made some kind of a deep impression on me. He was very nimble, very quick. I think one of the other guys who worked in the production department said, "Yeah, Jack's really fast." So anyway, Jack said to me, and he was a very quiet guy. I worked in and around Jack or met Jack over the years, and he never was very talkative. He said, "What's your name?" And I said, "Well, my name is Steve Mitchell." And so what Jack did was he wrote on the side of one of the buildings in the lower part of the page, "Steve Mitchell Industries." I was over the moon. The idea of having my name on a comic book cover was beyond anything I could have ever imagined. And I had a fairly good imagination, even as a kid. And so this cover was the, I believe they were working 2 or 3 months ahead. So every time Strange Adventures would come out, I'd be looking for it. I said, yeah, I'm going to see my name on a comic, but it's going to be great. And I can show it to my parents and they're not going to think I'm weird because I'm on a comic book cover. The cover comes out. And the building which had my name on it is covered by a caption. Now, maybe if we found the original and we peeled off the caption, which was a paste over, maybe Jack whited it out after I left. But in my mind, underneath that caption, to this day, is my name, which happened at those great DC offices. A couple of other guys that I met Mike Sikowski, who used to draw Justice League. Mike was a big, burly kind of guy who also was somewhat, I think, puzzled or maybe distrustful of these gushing fans who loved his work, because Mike did Justice League, which had Superman, Batman, Wonder Woman, Green Lantern, Flash, all of the characters that you know from DC, the most famous characters. But Mike was also drawing a thing called The Inferior Five. And it was one of the few humor books, and humor books never sold, but great people did work on them. Mike did The Inferior Five, Bob Oxner used to do the Dobie Gillis comics, the Jerry Lewis comics. Bob was a very, very talented guy who ultimately wound up working on Superman. He had penciled and inked a lot of stuff for Supergirl years later, but he also inked. He inked a lot of Kurt Swan stories, and he was very good and a nice guy. But Mike did me a little doodle of the blimp from Inferior Five. And one of the things that was also very impressive to me was just how simple it was and how quickly he did it. One of the things that I had to learn when I became a pro, I already was a fan, was we're creating art, but we're creating art that is going into what they would call magazines. Saul Harrison always referred to the comics as magazines because it was national periodical publications. It was a monthly. We weren't doing gallery work. We weren't doing stuff which we could noodle over or take our time. It had to be done regularly on deadline. And that was a very early lesson that I got when I started meeting these people at the DC offices. I also met Carmine Infantino before he was the publisher. And Carmine was very friendly, and he was always willing to talk about his work. And I always felt that Carmine's stuff was on a much different level because he incorporated design and negative space and great use of shapes. And we discussed that a lot, and he just was very articulate about what he did and how things were laid out on a page. And ultimately, he became the publisher, and some years later, not too many years later, Carmine was responsible for the layouts of just about every DC cover. What he did was give every artist sort of a rough, and they would follow it more or less. I think in Neil's case, not so much. Neil always did things his way, and I think Neil and Carmine probably had more, they butted heads, let's say that, more than maybe any other artist. But Carmine was very good at creating striking and dramatic pictures. And if you go back and you look at material from the Silver Age, one of the things that you'll see, as a fan I admire it, as a pro I admire it, is the fact that the covers grabbed you. Now granted, they would have these goofball captions on them. I'm looking at the cover for Strange Adventures, which has my name on it under the caption, but the caption read, plus a 2-in-1 sci-fi thriller, exclamation point, danger, Earth is doomed. The other caption was, another startling adventure of a mortal man, the man who lived and died 100 times. They were clearly not selling to a sophisticated audience, but what they were selling was fun and excitement and something that, you know, would be hopefully as entertaining as movies or television could be to grown-ups. At least they were to me. So anyway, those are some of the people that I met at DC Comics. There are many, many more, but they were some of the real standouts. And next time, we'll have more tales from my crazy past as a fan, ultimately becoming a pro, and I hope you enjoyed it. We'll talk to you soon. So if you have any comments, thoughts, or questions, please let us know. And if there's an anecdote or an answer I can provide for you, I will.
Feel free. We want to make this an interactive site, and we will be doing these podcasts every couple of weeks, and there will be new stories, new anecdotes, new thoughts about my comics history, but also, and maybe at some point, we'll talk about making films, which is something that I also have deep passion for. And so this can be your site as much as it can be our site, and your participation is appreciated and encouraged. And so tell your friends, obviously, that this is what we're doing, and hope to speak with you very soon.